Simon & Schuster Audio presents Challenger, a true story of heroism and disaster on the edge of space, by Adam Higginbotham. Read by Jacques Roy.
For Isla. Cast of characters. NASA Headquarters, Washington, D.C. Robert Frosch, Administrator, Head of NASA, 1977 to 1981. James Beggs, Administrator, Head of NASA, 1981 to 1986. William Graham, Deputy Administrator. Jesse Moore, Associate Administrator for Spaceflight, Overall Head of the Space Shuttle Program, 1984 to 1986. Mike Weeks, Deputy Associate Administrator for Spaceflight, Technical. Johnson Space Center, Houston, Texas. Christopher Kraft, Jr., Center Director, 1972 to 1982. George Abbey, Director of Flight Operations. Gene Kranz, Deputy Director of Flight Operations. John Young, Chief of the Astronaut Office. Arnold Aldrich, Space Shuttle Program Manager. Maxime Figet, Director of Engineering and Development. Tom Moser, Head of Structural Design, 1972 to 1982. Dorothy Dottie Lee, Subsystems Manager of Aerothermodynamics. Jay Green, Flight Director, Mission Control. Jenny Howard, Booster Systems Engineer, Mission Control. Steve Nesbitt, Public Affairs Officer, Johnson Space Center, Chief Commentator, Mission Control, 1986. Marshall Space Flight Center, Huntsville, Alabama. Werner von Braun, Center Director, 1960 to 1970. William Lucas, Center Director, 1974 to 1986. George Hardy, Deputy Director of Science and Engineering. Judson Levengood, Associate Director of Engineering and Propulsion. Stanley Reinarts, Manager, Shuttle Projects Office. Larry Malloy, Project Manager, Space Shuttle Solid Rocket Boosters. Kennedy Space Center, Merritt Island, Florida. Gene Thomas, Launch Director. Cecil Houston, Resident Manager for the Marshall Space Flight Center. Johnny Corlew, Quality Assurance Inspector, Pad Closeout Crew. Charlie Stevenson, Leader of the ICE Team, Engineering Department. Morton Thiokol, Wasatch Division, Utah. Jerry Mason, General Manager and Senior Vice President. Cal Wiggins, Deputy General Manager and Vice President. Bob Lund, Vice President of Engineering. Joe Kilminster, Vice President of Space Booster Programs. Alan McDonald, Director of the Space Shuttle Solid Rocket Motor Project. Arnie Thompson, Supervisor of Structures Design for Solid Rocket Motor Cases. Roger Beaujolais, Senior Scientist, Structural Mechanics, Space Shuttle Solid Rocket Motor Project. Bob Ebling, Manager, Final Assembly, Space Shuttle Solid Rocket Motor Project. Astronauts: Joe Allen, Jim Bajan, Guyon Bluford, Charles Bolden Jr., Manly Sonny Carter Jr., Richard Dick Covey, Bob Crippen, Anna Fisher, Robert Hoot Gibson, Frederick Gregory, Henry Hank Hartsfield, Frederick Rick Hauk, Bruce McCandless II, Ron McNair, Story Musgrave, George Pinky Nelson, Ellison Onizuka, Judy Resnick, Sally Ride, Francis Dick Scobie, Ray Seddon, Mike Smith, James Ox Van Hoften. The Space Participants: Jake Garn, Greg Jarvis, Krista McAuliffe, Barbara Morgan, Bill Nelson. The Rogers Commission: William Rogers, Chairman; Neil Armstrong, Vice Chairman; Dr. Richard Feynman, Nobel Prize-winning physicist; General Donald Katina, U.S. Air Force, former head of Pentagon Shuttle Operations. Titles in January 1986, unless otherwise noted. Prologue. Flight Control Room 2, Johnson Space Center, Houston, January 28, 1986, 8:30 a.m. The coffee, as usual, was terrible. Bitter and thin, the color of tea, almost certainly undrinkable. He filled a cup anyway, returned to his console, and plugged in his headset. It promised to be a long morning. Steve Nesbitt had arrived at his office early, checking for the latest weather updates from the Cape before taking the short walk out past the duck ponds to Building 30, and up in the elevator to the third floor of Mission Control. But from what he'd already seen on TV, there was no way they would launch today. It was freezing down in Florida, and there were 2-foot icicles hanging from the gantry. Space Shuttle Mission 51L seemed sure to face yet another delay. Nesbitt had been with NASA Public Affairs for just over 5 years, and was there for the triumph of the first space shuttle launch in 1981, helping to respond to a clamor of press and media inquiries from all over the world. Since then, he had become chief commentator for Mission Control, and delivered the live commentary from Houston on almost every one of the 24 shuttle flights. But he was still nervous. Responsibility for translating the bewildering patois of engineering jargon and acronyms spoken by NASA engineers and astronauts into language the public could understand began with the launch countdown commentary that boomed from the loudspeakers at Cape Canaveral. After that, once the count reached zero and the spacecraft left the ground, everything that happened was on Nesbitt's watch. There was no script, and he knew his words went out live to anyone watching a launch on television, either on the three national networks, on the recently launched cable channel CNN, or over NASA's own dedicated satellite feed. He relied instead on his Ascent Events list, which mapped a series of milestones the shuttle would pass on its way to orbit, from the slow roll it would execute as it roared away from the launch pad to the moment its main engines cut out, at the edge of space. The hushed environment of the flight control room had been devised to concentrate the minds of each of the flight controllers on their own tasks, and only recently had a TV set been installed near the flight director's console to display images of the shuttle in flight. Nesbitt rarely had time to look at that, as he focused attention on the console in front of him. Here, he had access to real-time information about the spacecraft. On his headset, he could listen in to dozens of audio loops connecting groups of NASA engineers and flight controllers on the internal communications network. On a pair of black-and-white monitors, he could see telemetry data transmitted back to Earth from the shuttle, columns of numbers updated every second, describing any one of thousands of technical parameters of its performance in flight. With more than 70 feeds to choose from, Nesbitt had his regular preferences. Flight ops procedures, which included data on the shuttle's engine performance, and the trajectory display, which showed its speed, altitude, and downrange distance. Even with all this at his fingertips, Nesbitt found the live commentary nerve-wracking, and practiced often. He took his duty of public service seriously, and hated it when other commentators took flight with flowery language like Hollywood PR guys. He wanted to play it straight. And yet, suffering from the effects of a cold he'd picked up the day before, even as the final countdown began, Nesbitt would have welcomed another launch delay. His throat was sore, and he wasn't certain he could talk through the whole ascent without his voice straining or cracking. He waited in silence for his cue, for the shuttle engines and the giant solid rockets to light, for his counterpart at the Cape to announce that Challenger had cleared the tower. It was almost exactly 11:38 in the morning when Nesbitt saw the numbers on his screen start to move, and a few seconds later keyed his mic to speak. Good roll program confirmed. Challenger now heading downrange. At the console position next to him, the flight surgeon, a Navy doctor in full uniform, had her eyes on the big TV set across the room. It was a perfect launch. Challenger was less than half a minute into flight when Nesbitt gave his next update. Engines beginning throttling down, now at 94%, he said. Normal throttle for most of the flight is 104%. We'll throttle down to 65% shortly. The flight surgeon watched the shuttle climb higher into the cloudless sky over the Atlantic. Nesbitt kept his gaze on the monitors. Velocity 2,257 feet per second, he said. Altitude 4.3 nautical miles. Downrange distance 3 nautical miles. The numbers all looked good. At 68 seconds, he reported the next key moment on the list in front of him. Engines are throttling up. Three engines now at 104%. 10 feet away, down on the next row of consoles, astronaut Richard Covey confirmed the range with the shuttle commander. Challenger, go at throttle up. Roger, go at throttle up. The spacecraft was 1 minute and 10 seconds into flight. 4 seconds later, Nesbitt heard a loud crackle in his headphones. Beside him, the surgeon saw Challenger abruptly obscured by a ball of orange and white flame. What was that? She said. But Nesbitt was staring at his monitors. 1 minute 15 seconds, velocity 2,900 feet per second, he said. Altitude 9 nautical miles, downrange distance 7 nautical miles. Then Nesbitt looked up and followed the surgeon's gaze toward the TV set. Something terrible had happened. There was no sign of Challenger, just the expanding fireball where it had once been, and the exhaust trails of the shuttle's 2 booster rockets twisting in opposite directions across the sky. His console was no help. The data streams had frozen. Around him, the other flight controllers sat stunned, faces slack with shock. No one said a word. Nesbitt knew he had to speak, but he had no information to explain what he was witnessing. His mind raced. He thought of his responsibility to the public and to the astronauts' families. He thought, suddenly, of the attempt on Ronald Reagan's life nearly 5 years before. In the confusion that followed, CBS News anchor Dan Rather had announced that White House Press Secretary James Brady had been killed, only to discover that Brady, despite the bullet in his head, remained very much alive. Nesbitt didn't want to make a mistake like that. A few moments of quiet extended into half a minute. An agonizing silence enveloped the NASA commentary loop, an eternity of dead air. On the TV screen, the cloud drifted in the wind. Fragments of debris fluttered toward the ocean. The flight director pulled his team in vain for answers. It was 41 seconds before Steve Nesbitt spoke again. Flight controllers here looking very carefully at the situation, he said, his voice flat and impassive. Obviously, a major malfunction. Part 1. The Last Man on the Moon. Chapter 1. Fire on Pad 34. Martha Chaffee was in her kitchen making hot dogs for the kids' dinner when she saw Michael Collins at the front door. In that moment, she realized she was a widow. The astronauts and their families formed a small, tight group in the neighborhood. Togethersville, they called it. And that evening, a few of the wives were already gathering in the living room of the Chaffee's yellow brick house on Barbuda Lane. Someone had mentioned an accident, but at first there seemed no reason for Martha to worry. The cars pulling up on the street outside could be part of the routine Friday evening exodus from work. Besides, although Martha's husband, Roger, was away training down at Cape Canaveral, he wasn't even scheduled to fly. Yet now Collins was standing on her doorstep, solemn and alone. There could be only one explanation. "I know, Mike," she said, "but you've got to tell me." She turned, and Collins followed her silently down the narrow hallway. In the den where her 2 children were watching the TV, someone reached over to turn it off before the news bulletins began. It was January 27th, 1967. At 31, Roger Chaffee was the youngest and most inexperienced of the 3 astronauts assigned to the crew of Apollo 1, NASA's first manned test flight in the new rocket program, intended to eventually land men on the moon. Dark-haired and good-looking, Chaffee had been an astronaut for a little more than 3 years, and had yet to fly in space. His rookie status was exaggerated by his baby face, his slight stature, and his archetypal straight-arrow background. A Boy Scout whose obsession with flight started early, building model planes with his barnstorming pilot father, a punctilious Navy aviator with a degree in aeronautical engineering from Purdue, where he had met Martha, the college homecoming queen. A devoted husband who drew up the blueprints for their home in Houston and liked to relax by building his own rifles and making ammunition, which he carried on weekend hunting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.